Tanser Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Black Butterfly, The Harmful Politics of Race and Space in America by Lawrence T. Brown, narrated by Lady Brion. Publisher's note, in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. May the rhythm of my heart stir music that enslaves darkness. May I stand in the midst of celestial fire until my heart is molten gold. Awakening Osiris, the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Introduction to Racial Equity. We had been drugged nearly to death by pro-slavery compromises. A radical change was needed in our whole system. Nothing is better calculated to affect the desired change than the slow, steady, and certain progress of the war. Frederick Douglass, The Mission of the War, January 13, 1864. The first bloodshed of America's Civil War occurred on April 19, 1861, during a deadly riot on Pratt Street in Baltimore when the city's Confederate sympathizers attacked Union Army troops passing through the city. The blood spilled that day near the intersection of Pratt and Light Streets belonged to 4 Union soldiers and 12 members of a pro-Confederate mob. In the aftermath, President Abraham Lincoln had to consider how to respond, since Marylanders willing to kill Union soldiers would certainly be willing to join the Confederate States of America, thus leaving Washington, D.C. completely surrounded by Confederates to the south, Virginia, and Confederates to the north, Maryland. When Baltimore's business leaders and residents demanded that Lincoln stop dispatching Union troops through the city, heading south to war with their Confederate friends, Lincoln snapped back, quote, "Go home and tell your people that if they will not attack us, we will not attack them. But if they do attack us, we will return it, and that severely," end quote. And with that, Lincoln placed Baltimore City under martial law. Throughout its long history, Baltimore has been a city defined by striking conflicts that threatened to tear the city apart. Traitorous Confederates versus loyal Unionists. White Baltimore police versus Black people grieving after Martin Luther King Jr.'s assassination. The Baltimore Police Department versus Black high school students grieving on the day Freddie Gray was laid to rest. Ever since blood was spilled during the Pratt Street riot, Baltimore has been a city warring with itself, just as America has remained in turmoil over the question of whether Black lives really matter. Since 2015, the term racial equity has increasingly become a popular buzzword in many philanthropic and government circles, coinciding with the rise of the movement for Black lives and hashtag Black Lives Matter. It has become fashionable, even popular, for public officials and philanthropic organizations to place the label, quote, racial equity, on their work while having little understanding of the precise ways Black neighborhoods were redlined or how racial segregation has been enforced and maintained. After declaring themselves to be staunch racial equity advocates, both politicians and philanthropists happily laud themselves for doing, quote, good work, without clarity concerning what racial equity means. Given the persistence and permanence of American racism, clarity about what racial equity is and why it is needed to make Black neighborhoods matter is vitally important. The reason government and organizations must foster racial equity across the nation is not to, quote, help Black neighborhoods, nor out of a fuzzy sense of moral obligation. Racial equity is required to dismantle American apartheid, which continues to damage thousands of Black neighborhoods across the nation. Throughout America's history, Black communities, cities, and economic districts have been repeatedly disrupted, deprived, demolished, and destroyed. Before the Civil War, free Black and Maroon communities were threatened by the clutches of enslavers and slave traders, along with the deployments of slave catchers and patrols. After the Civil War, the safety of Black communities was pierced by lynchers and white supremacist mobs who destroyed entire Black cities and business districts. In the 1910s, as the Great Migration commenced, cities began using racial zoning and white residents began using racially restrictive covenants to stop the, quote, Negro invasion. In the 1930s, the federal government partnered with local governments and real estate agents to draft residential security maps, which deliberately redlined and underdeveloped Black neighborhoods in more than 200 cities. In response to Black political activism and urban uprisings of the 1960s, the U.S. government intensified police repression and authorized a war on Black communities under color of the war on drugs, instead of fixing the damage that the federal government caused in those communities. Today, many Black neighborhoods at the core of hypersegregated metropolitan areas remain deeply redlined and are confronted with everything from urban apartheid to toxic pollution. As evidence of America's antipathy toward Black neighborhoods, both a Democrat and a Republican took turns demonizing and denigrating majority Black jurisdictions in Maryland within a span of several months in 2019. Their acidic language illustrates how Black neighborhoods are often viewed with disgust by elected officials and how America's abusive treatment of Black neighborhoods continues. Maryland delegate Mary Ann Lasanti, a Democrat representing Harford County, called Prince George's County the nation's wealthiest concentration of Black affluence, a, quote, nigger district. Just months later, Republican President Donald Trump lobbed an attack on Representative Elijah Cummings by tweeting that Baltimore is, quote, a disgusting, rat, and rodent-infested mess. If he spent more time in Baltimore, maybe he could help clean up this very dangerous and filthy place, end quote. In their stigmatizing language, neither Lasanti nor Trump acknowledged how local, state, and federal governments inflicted severe damage on Black neighborhoods and spaces through devastating policies, practices, systems, and budgets. This damage, sustained from intentional government actions, explains the conditions of such neighborhoods today. But Trump and Lasanti are not alone in devaluing Black neighborhoods. Research reveals that many white Americans harbor stereotypes about Black areas and devalue the real estate prices of homes in Black neighborhoods, even when they do not hold negative views about Black people. This discursive redlining has devastating consequences because it undergirds and underwrites policies, practices, systems, and budgets that impact Black neighborhoods. Lasanti's and Trump's racist rhetoric reveals how, quote, race has been understood in spatial terms that bound individuals and groups in place, classify them according to their geographical locations, and arrange them in a spatio-temporal hierarchy, end quote. Because of America's spatial racism, white neighborhoods and spaces are imagined as thriving and superior, while Black neighborhoods and spaces are deemed as doomed and inferior. Whether Black populations reside in wealthier places such as Prince George's County or less wealthy places such as Baltimore City, where majority Black populations reside does not matter. To chart a path forward so that Black neighborhoods can thrive, an honest examination of American history is needed. Racial equity is needed to dismantle spatial racism, a process, and produce spatial equity, the outcome. Racial equity is required to restore Black neighborhoods underdeveloped by deliberate public and private policies, practices, systems, and budgets. An authentic racial equity strategy will foster healing from past harms and support collective self-determination for the future. Implementing racial equity as a process or a strategy means building community wealth and boosting health without displacing existing residents. It means establishing budgets that equitably fund infrastructure, schools, recreation centers, and emergency preparedness. Producing racial equity as an outcome means restructuring policies, practices, systems, and budgets at the neighborhood level to foster spatial equity for redlined Black neighborhoods. To implement a robust racial equity strategy, government officials, philanthropies, corporations, and nonprofits must follow these five steps. 1. Obtain a deep understanding of historical trauma inflicted on Black neighborhoods. 2. Identify and stop all forms of ongoing historical trauma affecting Black neighborhoods. 3. Make decision-making participatory and deeply democratic for existing residents in redlined communities. 4. Ensure a meaningful community ownership and wealth-generating stake in all projects, programs, developments, and interventions using collective economics. 5. Make corrective and equitable budget allocations and funding choices to repair the damage caused by ongoing historical trauma on redlined neighborhoods. Each step must be implemented to foster healthy and wealthy Black neighborhoods. Racial equity starts with a reckoning. If an official, an entity, or an institution cannot explain the specific ways Black communities have been damaged, or if they have not deeply reflected on damage they may have inflicted personally or institutionally, then they are incapable of effectively undertaking the work needed to foster the development of healthy and wealthy Black neighborhoods. Book organization. This work is organized according to the five steps to implement a robust racial equity approach and designed to walk the listener through the types of reflection, analysis, and actions needed to develop thriving Black neighborhoods. Step 1. Track 1. The Trump Card. Track 2. This is America. Track 3. The Negro Invasion. Step 2. Track 4. Ongoing historical trauma. Track 5. Black neighborhood destruction. Steps 3 and 4. Track 6. Make Black neighborhoods matter. Step 5. Track 7. Healing the Black butterfly. The quote outro is written to inform the work of activists and organizers as they push for racial equity. Everybody has a role to play. Governments, systems, institutions, organizations, philanthropies, nonprofits, and public officials must engage in a serious, critical, and iterative process of reflection and truth-telling, followed by shifting budgets and implementing corrective action. Residents living in Black neighborhoods must become deeply engaged in urban planning and neighborhood design to chart their future. Residents in redlined Black neighborhoods and throughout the city must organize to confront ongoing historical trauma and engage in the work needed to restore Black neighborhoods. Methods and outline. Using redlined Black neighborhoods as my unit of analysis, I deploy multiple methods to arrive at the strategies, approaches, and recommendations in this volume. In Track 1, I analyze county-level racial demographic data, discuss recent urban uprisings, and offer an analysis of the current national political moment. In Track 2, I conduct a condensed historical analysis and policy review to lay bare the multiple ways that America has erected its own system of apartheid that damages redlined Black communities. In Track 3, I analyze the spatial policies and practices of Baltimore City and Baltimore County to reveal how the jurisdictions created an urban apartheid system of government-enforced racial segregation and forced displacement. In Track 4, I briefly discuss the concept of historical trauma and use Michelle Sotero's conceptual model of historical trauma to analyze how its effects are ongoing in redlined Black neighborhoods. In Track 5, I explain how ongoing historical trauma leads to Black neighborhood destruction and contextualize how the harms and damages sustained at the neighborhood level culminate in community health crises and catastrophes. In Track 6, I conduct a racial equity analysis of various systems in Baltimore to demonstrate how they play a role in perpetuating historical trauma. Following this, I discuss how each system can do its part to help dismantle Baltimore apartheid and make Black neighborhoods matter. In Track 7, I lay out 8 citywide strategies that can foster and promote the healing of redlined Black butterfly neighborhoods. I present an analysis of the city budget and discuss how various solutions can be financed. Baltimore looms large in this book because its history is intimately linked to the spread of American apartheid in large urban areas. More broadly, however, this book illuminates the crises and catastrophes occurring in America's Category 5 hypersegregated metropolitan areas and cities: Baltimore, Chicago, St. Louis, Birmingham, Flint, Detroit, Cleveland, and Milwaukee are all sister cities in the most intense and devastating category of racial hypersegregation. Since the Baltimore metropolitan area created the template for urban apartheid nationwide, perhaps it can construct the template for how other hypersegregated metropolitan areas can dismantle their apartheid systems and make Black neighborhoods truly matter. Each of these 8 metropolitan areas and other jurisdictions can replicate this type of racial equity analysis and approach to fostering concrete solutions by asking key questions. How did all parties contribute to the development of government-enforced racial segregation in this county, city, or area? How has serial forced displacement been carried out in this city or area? What are the policies, practices, systems, and budgets that inflict ongoing historical trauma on redlined Black neighborhoods in this city or area? What racial equity solutions are being implemented? How well did they work? And what future solutions should be deployed? These and other questions should be front and center for virtually every jurisdiction in the nation. Key terms: origins and definitions. Here are key terms or phrases that I use throughout the book, along with their origin and definition. American apartheid. As defined by Mindy Fullilove and colleagues, American apartheid is, quote, both a system of separation and serial forced displacement, end quote. Hence, American apartheid includes the government enforcement of both segregation by race and repeated forced uprootings of colonized and enslaved people. Baltimore apartheid, a term I coined to describe the city government's enforcement of both segregation by race and the repeated forced uprootings of Black people and neighborhoods. The Black butterfly, a term I coined to describe the geographic clustering where Black Baltimoreans live. The phrase denotes not only where Black Baltimoreans are geographically clustered, but also where capital is denied and structural disadvantages have accumulated due to the lack of capital access. Hence, the Black butterfly is more than a demographic description. It is a political, an economic, and a sociocultural description. Just as a butterfly's wings often have spots of varying colors, the same is true for the Black butterfly. There are white enclaves in the Black butterfly, such as Northern Park Heights and the 2 historically segregating universities that sit in East Baltimore, Johns Hopkins Medical Campus and West Baltimore, University of Maryland, Baltimore. Category 5 hypersegregation. I use hurricane categories as an analogy to describe metropolitan areas corresponding to the Massey-Tannen scheme of hypersegregation. Hence, I refer to metropolitan areas highly segregated along all 5 dimensions as Category 5 hypersegregated cities. There are 8 Category 5 hypersegregated metropolitan area core cities: Baltimore, Chicago, Detroit, Flint, St. Louis, Cleveland, Birmingham, and Milwaukee. Equity, a term I define as doing more for those communities that have less wealth and health due to ongoing historical trauma. Equity is a process of repairing damage and making communities whole. Gentrification. Many urbanists attempt to define gentrification without accounting for its racist and classist dimensions. The California-based group Causa Justa, Just Cause, has written such a definition in their report, Development Without Displacement, where they articulate, "We define gentrification as a profit-driven racial and class reconfiguration of urban, working class, and communities of color that have suffered from a history of disinvestment and abandonment. The process is characterized by declines in the number of low-income people of color in neighborhoods that begin to cater to higher-income workers willing to pay higher rents. Gentrification is driven by private developers, landlords, businesses, and corporations, and supported by the government through policies that facilitate the process of displacement, often in the form of public subsidies. The beauty of this definition is that it connects modern displacement with a, quote, history of disinvestment and abandonment, end quote. It is that very history that gives potency to the process of gentrification. The other thing this definition acknowledges is that gentrification is not merely the private markets at work. It is supported by public subsidies and constitutes a government policy or practice similar to urban renewal or highway construction through Black neighborhoods. The Great Rebellion. I define the contemporary period as the, quote, Great Rebellion from 2014 to 2020. I argue that urban uprisings between 2014 and 2017 were the first wave, while the uprisings and mass protests following the killing of George Floyd constitute the second wave. This naming convention follows the tradition of activists and historians who coined labels for other eras of racial upheaval. Such labels help Americans to contextualize and commemorate the nation's history of racialized violence and turmoil. Historian Douglas Egerton called post-Civil War violence the, quote, Wars of Reconstruction, end quote, roughly covering the period between 1866 and 1876. Activist James Weldon Johnson coined the phrase, quote, Red Summer, which took place in 1919. A large period of racial violence actually stretches roughly from 1917, riot in East St. Louis, to 1923, the destruction of Black Wall Street in Tulsa and Rosewood, Florida. Historian Peter Levy called urban uprisings during the civil rights and Black Power eras the, quote, Great Uprising, stretching from 1963 to 1971. Historical trauma. A conceptual framework first articulated by Maria Yellow Horse Braveheart. Historical trauma was advanced as a public health conceptual framework by Michelle Sotero, who described historical trauma as, quote, the premise that populations historically subjected to long-term mass trauma exhibit a higher prevalence of disease even several generations after the original trauma occurred, end quote. Mass traumas include war, imperialism, genocide, apartheid, slavery, and caste. I conceptualize ongoing historical trauma as the intergenerational effects of past mass traumas combined with the contemporary structural violence that continue to inflict damage on vulnerable racial and ethnic groups and impose spatial inequity on their land or in their neighborhoods. This damage is transmitted through public and private policies, practices, systems, and budgets. Hyperpolicing. A term I coined to discuss a system of aggressive racial profiling and militarized policing based on a combination of U.S. Supreme Court decisions, presidential executive orders, and federal laws that authorize the disproportionate policing strategies in Black neighborhoods. Because of its aggressiveness and resulting brutality, hyperpolicing breeds mistrust as police do not, quote, protect and serve Black neighborhoods with the same courtesy and respect afforded to other communities. Hence, Black neighborhoods are often paradoxically hyperpoliced yet underprotected. Hypersegregation. A concept developed by Douglas Massey and Nancy Denton. According to Massey and Tannen, hypersegregation, quote, describes metropolitan areas in which African Americans were highly segregated on at least four of the five dimensions, end quote, of spatial racial segregation. Here are the five dimensions according to Massey and Tannen. Unevenness is the degree to which Blacks and whites are unevenly distributed across neighborhoods in a metropolitan area. Isolation is the extent to which African Americans live in predominantly Black neighborhoods. Clustering is the degree to which neighborhoods inhabited by African Americans are clustered together in space. Concentration is the relative amount of physical space occupied by African Americans within a given metropolitan environment. And centralization is the degree to which Blacks reside near the center of a metropolitan area. Racial equity, a term I define as taking restorative actions to help redlined Black communities organize themselves in order to heal from ongoing historical trauma. This requires fully acknowledging and stopping all manifestations of ongoing historical trauma. Hence, racial equity is not simply a, quote, lens or perspective. Racial equity is a process comprising five steps outlined earlier and described in more detail throughout this book. In a racially segregated society, racial equity as an outcome is contingent on achieving spatial equity, where resources and amenities are intentionally deployed based on demonstrated neighborhood needs, while disamenities are removed or dismantled based on disproportionate neighborhood harms. There can be no racial equity without spatial equity. Redlining. Denying Black neighborhoods equitable access to private financial capital and equitable spending on public goods. Redlining is an ongoing process of wealth denial practiced in Black neighborhoods across the country. Private bank redlining was formalized with the drafting of residential security maps in nearly 250 cities by the federal government with the aid of local governments. The maps featured four color codes: red, blue, yellow, and green, to help the federal government and banking institutions determine which communities received capital access, green, blue, and yellow, and which did not, red. The differential spending on public goods in segregated cities from the early 1900s onward, particularly in Black neighborhoods, is an often unrecognized form of redlining. Serial forced displacement. A term coined by researchers Mindy Fullilove and Roderick Wallace that includes public and private policies and practices such as, quote, segregation, redlining, urban renewal, planned shrinkage / catastrophic disinvestment, deindustrialization, mass criminalization, gentrification, Hope Six, and the foreclosure crisis, end quote. I view serial forced displacement as the forced uprooting of people and communities in concert with land seizures. It can sometimes take the form of withdrawing critical resources in communities, such as mass school closures, school takeovers, recreation center closures, and the demolition and privatization of public housing. Segronomics, a term coined by Noliwe Rooks as, quote, the business of profiting specifically from high levels of racial and economic segregation, end quote. Although she examines segronomics from an education lens, I find her term useful to explain how Black neighborhoods are denied equitable spending on public goods and private capital, e.g. redlining, and how economic exploitation is practiced in Black neighborhoods, e.g. subpriming or predatory lending and taxation. In some instances, I equate segronomics with the internal colonization of Black neighborhoods in America through wealth extraction. In short, segronomics is the economic weaponization of government-enforced racial segregation. Whitelash, a term dropped by Van Jones on CNN on election night in November 2016 that combines white and backlash. As Jones articulated regarding the results of the election, quote, "This was a white lash against a changing country. It was white lash against a Black president in part, and that's the part where the pain comes," end quote. I define white lash as the racist American tradition of backlash against Black progress rooted in a zero-sum framework. The white L, a description of the geographic clustering where white Baltimoreans live. The white L describes not only where white Baltimoreans live, but also where access to capital is most readily available and structural advantages have accrued due to that capital access. Hence, the white L is more than a demographic description, but a political, economic, and social-cultural description. There are also historically Black enclaves in the white L, such as Sharp Leadenhall, Hose Heights, and Cross Keys Village. White supremacy, an ideological, philosophical, and theological perspective that spawns institutions, policies, practices, systems, and budgets that incur structured advantages for white people and neighborhoods and create structured disadvantages for Black, Brown, and Native people and neighborhoods. Structural advantages include material wealth, access to capital, high-quality public goods, respectful policing, and land ownership, while structured disadvantages include wealth extraction, lack of access to capital, poor-quality public goods, hyper-policing, and forced displacement or uprootings. A new vision for public health must emerge. Public health cannot simply focus on the health of generalized populations. Public health must evolve and uplift community health with emphasis on the particular spaces and places where people live. This means adopting an explicitly spatial-temporal framework that views community health as deeply informed by history and influenced by previous policies, practices, systems, and budgets. In a nation founded on the colonization of Native nations' lands and the current rise of what Samuel Stein calls the, quote, real estate state, end quote, spatial racism is alive and well. In America, Black neighborhoods are treated as places for pilfering and profiteering, as spaces for extraction and exploitation. This work is an interruption and an intervention that posits that it is impossible to make Black lives matter without making Black neighborhoods matter. Why tracks instead of chapters? Because the work of bolstering community health is as much about fusing art and storytelling as it is about conveying science. I often listen to music while I am writing and suffuse my writing with spoken word, poetry, rhythm, and song. While I draw heavily from research and social science, I also draw from the wellspring of Black speculative visions ranging from Parliament Funkadelic's Mothership to Black Panther's Wakanda. This book is infused with Afrofuturistic ecological thinking, a mode of thinking that says healthy Black people and thriving Black neighborhoods exist in the future. It is up to this nation, along with its cities and counties, to make this future a functional reality. Finally, some may ask, why should I care about urban Black neighborhoods since I live in a safe and secure suburb or exurb? To these persons, I will respond that people living in all areas of America should care because the social and economic advantages involved in the creation and maintenance of suburbs and exurbs help exacerbate many of the disadvantages that exist in urban areas and Black neighborhoods. I also present the thinking of President Lincoln when he offered his analysis of a bitterly divided nation while running for Congress in 1858. A house divided against itself cannot stand. I believe this government cannot endure permanently half slave and half free. I do not expect the union to be dissolved. I do not expect the house to fall. But I do expect it will cease to be divided. It will become all one thing or all the other. Lincoln was partially wrong. By 1861, the Union was dissolved. The House did fall. America was soon ensnared in a brutal and bloody war. Although formal hostilities ceased, the nation still wrestles with its structural and spatial sins. In 2020, COVID-19 snatched over 200,000 lives, and the Great Rebellion engulfed the nation in the flames of uprisings, riots, and looting after police killed George Floyd in Minneapolis. The nation is currently teetering on its axis as American apartheid threatens to tear the nation apart. America is splintering politically because it is fractured spatially. The nation cannot endure by denying spatial equity and maintaining urban apartheid. Either the nation will make racial equity a reality or succumb to the infernal outcomes of American apartheid. It will become all one thing or the other. A radical change is needed in our whole system. America will not move forward until there is a great reckoning where Americans fully acknowledge the legacy of white supremacist violence and terrorism unleashed during the Wars of Reconstruction, 1866 through 1876, and again during the period encompassing the Red Summer, 1917 through 1923. The nation will not know tranquility until it addresses the root causes of the Black pushback during the Great Uprising, 1963 through 1971. And more recently, during the Great Rebellion, 2014 through 2020. If we, the people of the United States of America, wish to bequeath to posterity a thriving nation, the nation must undergo a reckoning with its wrongs and make amends for its past. Only this reckoning, followed by radical change, can make racial equity a concrete reality and make Black neighborhoods matter. Track 1. The Trump Card. Excuse me, could I please ask a favor? Could we really integrate like the layers of a flavor? Could a Black girl that's urban have suburban girls as neighbors? Martina Lynch, Fences. They're celebrating our deaths like it's a badge of honor, and all those degrees don't mean a damn thing. Every time I see a video or hear a gunshot, I feel that in my chest, and I can't sleep because my soul can't rest, because I can't help but think, what if that was me? Asia Cross, Officer Don't Shoot. White Lash. Quote, Trump triumphs, end quote. Read the stunning headline on November 9, 2016. After the election of Barack Obama in 2008, pundits and demographers declared that the democratic destiny of the United States was in favor of the Democratic Party. By 2042, or thereabouts, America would be a, quote, majority-minority, and America would reach its status as a multicultural oasis and post-racial promised land. But America's true demographic destiny was revealed on November 9, 2016, in the early hours after the election. There are 3,142 counties across the nation. Out of these, 413 counties are 98% or more white in population. Another 1,413 counties are between 90% and 97.99% white, while 504 counties are between 80% and 89.99% white. This means that, in nearly three-fourths of all counties in the United States, white people are 80% of the population or more. By contrast, over 80% of all Black people in the United States live in the remaining 791 counties. Perhaps nothing captures the capacity for future political dominance better than the fact that 1,847 counties are 90% or more white, but only 185 counties are 10% white or less. Unsurprisingly, Trump did best in the demographically whitest counties. Currently, 21 metropolitan areas in the United States are hypersegregated, and another 32 are classified as highly segregated. The 21 hypersegregated metro areas contain 26% of the nation's Black population, and approximately 22.5 million Black people live in the nation's top 50 largest cities, roughly 53% of the entire Black population. The spatial clustering of people by race is both a national phenomenon and a metropolitan phenomenon. While Black America is spatially clustered in highly or hypersegregated urban areas, white Americans are the supermajority in 3/4 of all counties in the United States, many of them rural counties. Asian Americans are also highly concentrated in the 719 counties that are less than 80% white, while Native Americans are concentrated disproportionately on reservations. This translates into a high degree of white demographic power in the realm of politics. By being the supermajority population in so many counties and in so many rural areas, white America will be ensured significant advantages in electing the majority of senators to Congress and the president by means of the Electoral College. The ability to win elections with a minority of the popular vote and the election of 2 senators per state, regardless of population size, gives significant advantages to rural areas and states with smaller populations. Even as America becomes a true rainbow nation, 2 of the most powerful political entities can potentially remain in the hands of white Americans. And since the president nominates U.S. Supreme Court justices and the Senate confirms Supreme Court nominees, the 3 major political branches of government can possibly be run by a white minority population because of American apartheid. Donald Trump's election in 2016 reveals the way that American apartheid will continue to give outsized power and influence to white voters seeking to maintain white privilege and power. Trump was electorally supported by 81% of white evangelical-born Christians, 63% of white male voters, 53% of white female voters, 49% of white college graduates, and 48% of all voters earning over $100,000. He also won all of these categories over Democratic candidate Hillary Clinton, with overt appeals to bigotry and the slogan, "Make America Great Again." Especially after 8 years of the first Black president, Trump's election embodied a white lash against perceived Black progress. But white lash is nothing new. It is a time-honored tradition in American history. America is notorious for backsliding on progress benefiting Black lives. The slogan, "Make America Great Again," echoes the politics animating white redemption designed to roll back Black Reconstruction in the 1870s and recalls the Southern strategy designed to unravel the progress of the civil rights and Black power movements in the 1970s and 1980s. America is now in a moment where white redemption in national politics is being deployed for the 3rd time. Each deployment has had disturbing aims. First, American white lash, dismantle and diminish Black Reconstruction. Second, American white lash, reverse gains obtained by civil rights and Black power movement activists. Third, American white lash, repeal and replace President Barack Obama's policies and legacy. The Trump presidency is the culmination of the 3rd iteration of white lash. Nearly every policy that President Barack Obama passed or pushed has been systematically targeted for elimination, nullification, or repeal by the Trump administration. But the broader national animus directed against Obama's legacy can be explained with political science data. Research revealed that white Americans with more fear of immigrants causing cultural displacement had an increased likelihood of supporting Trump. A Reuters survey revealed that Trump supporters were significantly more likely to view Black people as less intelligent, more lazy, more rude, more violent, and more criminal than Clinton supporters or even other Republican candidates, e.g., Ted Cruz and John Kasich. Still, Other analyses highlight the centrality of racism in Trump's ascendance and governance. As Frances Cress Welsing remarked shortly before her death, quote, Donald Trump's Trump card is the race card in the system of racism slash white supremacy, end quote. The reduction in protection under the law. Although many people expressed alarm over the election of Donald Trump, the Supreme Court was already at work stripping away the legal protection of Black lives and the enforcement of Black people's civil rights. In 2005, President George W. Bush nominated John Roberts to the Supreme Court to serve as the Chief Justice. Under the Roberts Court, the great 1960s Civil Rights Acts and previous Brown v. Board of Education decisions have been systematically undermined. As just one example, the 2016 Utah v. Strafe Supreme Court decision undermined the 14th Amendment's Equal Protection Clause and earned a stinging rebuke from Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor, who wrote in dissent, "This court has allowed an officer to stop you for whatever reason he wants, so long as he can point to a pretextual justification after the fact. That justification must provide specific reasons why the officer suspected you were breaking the law, but it may factor in your ethnicity, where you live, what you were wearing, and how you behaved. The officer does not even need to know which law you might have broken, so long as he can later point to any possible infraction, even one that is minor, unrelated, or ambiguous." This judicial retrenchment is conjoined with the Republican Party's political ascendance. The GOP Tea Party has been ramping up toward the current moment, especially after the 2008 election of President Obama. On October 23, 2010, Kentucky Senator Mitch McConnell gave voice to the GOP Tea Party's aim, quote, "The single most important thing we want to achieve is for President Obama to be a one-term president," end quote. Although McConnell failed to stop in Obama's second term, President Trump would succeed in rolling back Obama's policy legacy. By refusing to confirm Merrick Garland, Obama's pick for the Supreme Court, the GOP Tea Party flipped the high court and ensured conservative judicial dominance for the foreseeable future. Urban uprisings and historical trauma. Just as Trump's triumph and the future political dominance of white Americans can be explained by America's enduring apartheid, so can the urban uprisings Americans have witnessed since the killing of Mike Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, during the presidency of Barack Obama. During the first wave of the Great Rebellion, urban uprisings erupted in six metropolitan areas: Ferguson, Baltimore, Minneapolis, Baton Rouge, Charlotte, and St. Louis. If Americans understand, quote, "a riot is the language of the unheard," end quote, as once described by Martin Luther King Jr., then it behooves the nation to learn to interpret that, quote, "language" and listen to what the unheard have been attempting to convey. Black people in the United States have long endured historical trauma since their arrival as indentured servants on American shores over 400 years ago. But it is equally important to remember that the history of African Americans has not just been one of victimization in the face of unrelenting trauma, violence, and brutality. It is also one of resilience, resistance, and revolution in opposition to race-based exploitation and domination. However, historical trauma does inflict lasting damage in redlined Black neighborhoods. Public health scholar Michelle Sotero outlined four ways that ongoing historical trauma damages community health. 1, segregation / forced displacement. 2, physical / psychological violence. 3, economic destruction. And 4, cultural dispossession. These four components of historical trauma have devastating impacts on the health of African Americans in the United States. Explaining further, researcher Sarah Malotain argues, quote, "Historical trauma is not an event, but a series of lived events over time, a process that requires systemic rather than only individual intervention, end quote. Without systemic intervention, the symptoms of historical trauma will remain unchecked and unresolved. Since a large proportion of Black people in America are demographically clustered in metropolitan areas and core urban areas, understanding the impact of the four main components of historical trauma can only be ascertained by examining core urban areas' policies, practices, systems, and budgets that damage Black neighborhoods and hurt and harm Black lives. This volume elucidates how hypersegregated cities have functioned as the tip of the American apartheid spear in the lives of millions of African Americans, leading to militant protest and community police confrontations in cities such as Ferguson, Baltimore, Minneapolis, Baton Rouge, Charlotte, Milwaukee, and St. Louis during the first wave of the Great Rebellion from 2014 to 2017. Urban uprisings do not erupt out of thin air. They occur after a community has been pushed to the edge. The Baltimore Uprising. By the afternoon of April 27, 2015, Baltimore was on fire. That fateful morning, a West Baltimore man named Freddie Gray was being funeralized and laid to rest in that afternoon. His death, by hyper-policing, occurred after he was chased and then arrested by Baltimore police officers on April 12th. Freddie Gray was denied immediate medical attention, although he was writhing and screaming in pain as he was placed in the police van. He was in a coma for a week and died on April 19th. A little over a week later, at 11:39 a.m., on the morning of April 27th, Baltimore police officials released a memo of, quote, a credible threat that local gangs were uniting to kill cops and claimed that Black youth were getting together to conduct a lawless purge after they got out of school at 3 p.m. These police claims would later be classified as unsubstantiated or disproven, but the fear-mongering had already been done. As a result of salacious reports, the Baltimore Police Department, BPD, deployed police in riot gear and stopped high school students from going home by shutting down buses adjacent to Monument Mall in West Baltimore. Grieving, frustrated, and unable to go home, Black youth began throwing rocks at the police. Baltimore police responded by launching rocks, rubber bullets, and tear gas at the teenage students. Afterward, the situation devolved. Looting commenced, stores and police cars were set afire, and by nightfall, the city was under a state of emergency. Although the events of April 27th unfolded rapidly, the uprising erupted against a bubbling historical backdrop. The street shutdowns and protests against police brutality, along with the emergent Movement for Black Lives protest the previous year. On September 15, 2014, a Black police officer was captured on camera pummeling a cowering victim with his fists in Baltimore. On September 28, 2014, Baltimore Sun reporter Mark Puente published a hard-hitting investigative story called Undue Force, highlighting how the BPD had brutalized many victims. The reporting sparked the city of Baltimore to request a, quote, collaborative review with the U.S. Department of Justice, DOJ, regarding police violence. Roughly 2 months later, on November 24th and December 3rd, 2014, Ferguson and New York prosecutors announced that Officer Darren Wilson and New York Police Department officers would not be indicted for their actions involving the deaths of Mike Brown and Eric Garner, respectively. Mourners around the nation joined together in solidarity to protest and express their outrage that the law enforcers responsible for the killings of Brown and Garner would not be charged or called to account. On December 16, 2014, after days of rolling protests and street shutdowns, a 19-year-old Black male, Dante Jones, shot a West Baltimore police officer, reportedly out of fear that he would be killed like recent victims of police shootings. While tensions simmered over the winter months, the DOJ convened a meeting on April 16, 2015, 4 days after Freddie Gray was arrested and ended up in a coma, where roughly 300 Baltimore residents spoke out about their grievances against the BPD. 2 days later, residents of Gilmore Homes, a public housing community where Gray lived, began marching down to and assembling at the Western District Police Station to protest the police brutality that led to Freddie Gray's hospitalization. Therefore, when Freddie Gray died on April 19th, months of anger and frustration boiled over and were punctuated by moving protests, many of which spread from the Western District, snaked through traffic crossing Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard, and arrived downtown, resulting in business shutdowns. On April 23rd, Gene Ryan, head of the Baltimore Fraternal Order of Police, publicly declared that peaceful protesters, quote, looked like a lynch mob, end quote, introducing inflammatory rhetoric that reflected an escalated BPD's tactical deployment against protesters. Thousands of Baltimore residents and protesters would hold massive marches during this weekend, demanding justice for Freddie Gray. On Saturday, April 25th, after a gathering and speech held by Malik Shabazz in front of City Hall, a mixed crowd of protesters and predominantly white Baltimore Orioles fans clashed as windows of cars and buildings near the baseball stadium were smashed in what the Baltimore City paper dubbed the, quote, clash at Camden Yards, end quote. Later that night, Baltimore police officers swarmed and attacked protesters near the Western District, including reporter Baynard Woods. The Baltimore City paper dubbed it, quote, the Battle of Sandtown Winchester, end quote. Thus, when fires burned in multiple locations across the city on April 27th, it was the culmination of months of street protests, inflammatory rhetoric, and concussive clashes between city protesters and suburban residents or police. In the span of 8 days, the city had gone from the death of Freddie Gray, April 19th, to the clash at Camden Yards and the Battle of Sandtown Winchester, April 25th and 26th, to the Mundaumin Mall bus shutdown by police and subsequent uprising, April 27th. The city would be placed under curfew for 5 days following the April 27th civil disturbance, causing stress and strain, particularly for the late-night workers and businesses. On Friday, May 1st, Baltimore City's state's attorney, Marilyn Mosby, proclaimed that the 6 BPD officers involved in the death of Freddie Gray would be indicted. There was an eruption of jubilation and joy as many Black Baltimoreans celebrated that possibility that there might actually be justice for Freddie Gray. That catharsis would soon subside as none of the officers involved in the death of Freddie Gray would be found guilty. Crises and catastrophes in hypersegregated cities. Why did several Black communities explode into shutdowns and uprisings between 2014 and 2017? Examining data on racial hypersegregation in a metropolitan area provides an explanation. The core urban cities in the 21 hypersegregated metropolitan areas contain redlined Black neighborhoods that have been deeply damaged by apartheid policies and practices that result in devastating resource deprivation. At the same time, predominantly white neighborhoods benefit from an influx in public dollars and private capital. Therefore, hypersegregation results in the hyperallocation of resources to white neighborhoods and the hyperdeprivation of resources in Black neighborhoods. Starving neighborhoods of critical resources foster places where crime and violence are likely to fester. Instead of responding to crime and violence by reversing economic and resource deprivation, most municipalities respond to crime and violence in redlined Black neighborhoods with hyperpolicing. The legal framework for hyperpolicing in redlined Black neighborhoods has been structured by several pivotal but little-known Supreme Court decisions: Terry v. Ohio, 1968, Graham v. Connor, 1989, Illinois v. Wardlow, 2000, and Utah v. Strafe, 2016. These decisions established case law that authorized discriminatory police practices, including stop and frisk, the killings of unarmed people if officers claim fear for their lives, differential policing in neighborhoods deemed, quote, high crime areas, and the legalization of unlawful investigatory stops. These Supreme Court decisions, along with other pieces of congressional legislation and presidential executive orders, collectively create the legal basis for hyperpolicing Black neighborhoods. Hyperpolicing elevates the likelihood that police-citizen interactions will escalate into scenarios where police, who often are not residents of the cities they patrol, bring their racial biases and stereotypes with them when they encounter Black residents living in redlined neighborhoods damaged by apartheid. Instead of blaming the conditions in redlined Black communities on national, state, and local urban policies, police officers most often ascribe conditions to the residents. The toxic stew of resource apartheid, racial biases, and hyper-policing contribute to police brutality and the fatal police shootings of Black persons such as Mike Brown, Ayanna Stanley Jones, Tamir Rice, Philando Castile, Corinne Gaines, and Freddie Gray. The police killings of unarmed Black people, followed by the lack of indictments and convictions, often lights the match that sparks the fire of an urban uprising. After SARS-CoV-2, commonly called the novel coronavirus, began spreading rapidly across the nation in February 2020, America was once again on the edge. In mid-March, governors across the nation ordered people to shelter in place and businesses closed. The toll of the coronavirus soon became clear. In a period of less than 3 months, over 100,000 Americans died due to COVID-19 and 40 million people were thrown into unemployment. Black Americans died at a disproportionate rate as SARS-CoV-2 took root in redlined neighborhoods in the nation's cities with legacies of hypersegregation. In doing so, COVID-19 exposed the fault lines embedded within American apartheid. While COVID-19 radically altered American life, another pandemic was also stalking Black lives. The stories of the vigilante killing of Ahmaud Arbery in Brunswick, Georgia, and the police killing of Breonna Taylor in Louisville, Kentucky, began circulating more widely throughout March and April. By late May, Black America was set to explode. When Minneapolis police officers killed George Floyd by kneeling on his neck for over 8 minutes and 46 seconds on Memorial Day, Black America was thunderstruck with intense grief. The video of the slow and deliberate police killing of Floyd elicited fire and fury. After viewing the video, South Minneapolis exploded in riot, protest, fires, and looting. Los Angeles, Denver, Memphis, and Atlanta exploded next by the same means by the end of the week. By mid-June, over 3,200 cities had erupted in protest. The National Guard was activated in over 25 states. In some cities, protests were often followed by rioting, setting police vehicles on fire, looting, and property destruction. In Minneapolis, where George Floyd was killed by Minneapolis officer Derek Chauvin, protesters and city residents were so insistent in their militance that they overwhelmed the Minneapolis police and forced them to abandon their third precinct building. The nationwide riotous turmoil in 2020 echoed the Holy Week uprisings in 1968. Historian Peter Levy dubbed the period from 1963 to 1971 the Great Uprising, an era which witnessed over 750 uprisings. The Great Uprising is an appropriate phrase that helps convey the totality of the frustration and anger that Black people experienced, as well as the conditions to which they were responding. In a similar vein, I call the period from 2014 to 2020 the Great Rebellion, to explain the era of urban uprisings that took place between 2014 and 2017, Wave 1, and nationwide protests and uprisings in 2020, Wave 2. American apartheid is the root cause for both the Great Uprising and the Great Rebellion. Hypersegregation breeds hyperpolicing. Civic leaders continually ignore hypersegregation while elected officials repeatedly authorize hyperpolicing that leads directly to fatal police shootings. Spatial racism sparks the fires of crises and catastrophes burning in many urban communities. During the first wave of the Great Rebellion, urban uprisings took place largely in Category 5 hypersegregated metropolitan areas, signaling the depths of despair and frustration simmering in many American cities. The cascading crises and catastrophes that rock redlined Black neighborhoods in each of the Category 5 hypersegregated core cities are presented in Table 1.2. Table 1.2, Crises and Catastrophes in 8 Category 5 Hypersegregated Cities. Category 5 City, Baltimore, Issues and Crises, Mass Protests for Freddie Gray in mid-April 2015, Police Occupation and April 27, 2015, Mondawmin Uprising, second in 2017 murder rate, second in rental evictions. Category 5 City, Flint, Issues and Crises, 2016 ongoing lead poisoning crisis under emergency management by state. Category 5 City, Detroit, Issues and Crises, third in 2017 murder rate, first in rental evictions, mass school closures, teacher sick outs, under emergency management by state. Category 5 City, Chicago, Issues and Crises, fifth in 2017 murder rate, protest against violence, mass school closures, school funding crisis, South Shore residents clash with police after shooting of Harith Augustus on July 14, 2018. Potential uprising averted after former officer Van Dyke was judged guilty in the killing of Laquan McDonald in August 2018. Category 5 City, St. Louis and Ferguson, Issues and Crises, Mass Protests for Mike Brown, Police Occupation and 2014 Ferguson Rebellion, 2017 St. Louis Uprising, Mass Protests in the City, First in 2017 Murder Rate. Category 5 City, Birmingham, Issues and Crises, Three Straight Years of Increasing Murder Rate, School Resegregation, White School District Separation, Spike in Drug Overdose Deaths. Category 5 City, Cleveland, Issues and Crises, May 23, 2015, uprising in response to the not guilty verdict of Officer Michael Brillo, police killing of 12-year-old Tamir Rice on November 22, 2014, and protest after non-indictment of Officer Timothy Lowman, lead poisoning crisis. Category 5 City, Milwaukee, Issues and Crises, August 14th and 15th, 2016, Sherman Park Uprising after killing of Seville Smith by police, high homicide rates, 2018 lead poisoning crisis. If the first wave of the Great Rebellion was the stunning prelude, then the second wave was the smashing crescendo. The crises of hypersegregation and hyperpolicing that simmered beneath the surface began bubbling and boiling over from large hypersegregated cities and started spilling into protests and demonstrations for racial justice in smaller communities. The profound anguish and rage unleashed during the Great Rebellion revealed that hypersegregated cities are linked with suburbs, small towns, and rural communities. The same is true with COVID-19, which also first spread heavily in hypersegregated cities. In the early 1900s, white Americans attempted to cordon off Black people into redlined urban neighborhoods. But ultimately, what starts in redlined neighborhoods spills over into the rest of the nation. By June 2020, the cauldron of racial and spatial inequity boiled over, leaving no part of the nation unscathed nor unscarred. Conclusion. Perhaps it is the constant crises and catastrophes or the sense of being under attack that provoked Baltimore City spoken word artists Asia Cross and Martina Lynch to pointedly question and critique America. In Officer Don't Shoot, Asia Cross, a trauma nurse and Morgan State University graduate, narrates the ominous shadow of death that impacts the mental health of Black people in America due to police brutality. Every time I see a video or hear a gunshot, I feel that in my chest, and I can't sleep because my soul can't rest. In her piece Fences, Lynch pointedly asks if a Black girl born in Baltimore City can be neighbors with a white girl in one of Baltimore County's suburbs. Listening to Asia and Martina, one can hear the voices of thousands of Baltimore's Black children, especially those that grow up in deeply redlined Black neighborhoods, wondering whether peace, safety, and suburban spaces are meant for them. Are safe and healthy neighborhoods meant for a Black child growing up in redlined neighborhoods in hypersegregated cities like Baltimore? Should Black children have to aspire to leave their neighborhoods to find safety and security? Martina and Asia should not have to question America and the allocation of resources and safety in urban versus suburban spaces, in the land of the free and home of the brave. If America is to ever move forward as a nation, everyone should question why many Black people feel unsafe. Americans can start by asking, how did America become a nation so characterized by devastatingly deep spatial and racial divides? Track 2. This is America. If the Freedom Democratic Party is not...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.